Let us look at manual exchanges in this slide. The operation is very simple and most of us already know this. The operation of the operator assisted manual exchange is very well known. These type of exchanges used switch assemblies and plugs and jacks. All the local exchange hardware are duplicated for each subscriber except the ringing generator, operator's headset and the battery. Let us say X wants to call Y. X lifts the handset and the exchange detects this loop. DC current flows in this loop. A lamp gets activated and the operator's attention is drawn to this. Operator then talks to X and finds out the number of the desired call party Y. Operator closes Y's circuit and rings him or her by using a ring key and a ring generator. User X is parked all the while. When Y answers, his LED is activated and the operator talks to Y and then patches X and Y through a patch cord. Both lights of A and B are on as long as they talk. If any one or both lamps goes off, the operator will disconnect the jacks. Limitations of manual exchanges. It is language dependent, it lacks privacy, there could be a switching delay, the operator may be busy attending to several calls and one has to wait for one's turn. Only a limited number of features were possible. These are some of the drawbacks of manual exchanges. Then came step-by-step switching, the famous Strowger exchange. Look at the figure. The Strowger switching is a step-by-step switching. The system consists of elements such as subscriber's line circuit, allotter, line finder, group selector and final selector. Figure shows the block diagram of a typical Strowger switching, which explains the process by which the switching system connects a calling subscriber and a called subscriber. Look at the new figure that's appearing. The figure shows a simplified routing of a local call in a Strowger switching system. The line finder shown is what is known as a two-motion selector. What's a two-motion selector? In the figure, look at the two-motion selectors in the group selector stage. Let us say the calling subscriber wants to talk to someone whose telephone number is 5345. Therefore, she dials 5345. In this example, the first digit received is 5 and the first two-motion selector wiper sweeps vertically to the fifth contact and it arrives at the fifth row of the two-motion selector. All the terminals on this row can connect eventually through other switches only to those phones whose first digit starts with 5. Now, this first selector connects to the second selector which responds to the second digit. In our example, the second digit is 3. And therefore, the second two-motion selector wiper moves vertically to the third contact. This indicates that one of the many possible subscribers whose first two digits are 5 and 3 are selected. Still not the desired call party, but someone with starting number as 53. This process repeats in the next selector, which is a single switch called final selector. When this selector receives the first digit, the wiper moves vertically that many steps. When the selector receives the second digit, the wiper moves horizontally that many steps. The next two digits received are 4, 5 in our example and you can see how the wiper has moved from this figure. That is where our desired call subscribers line is already terminated. Next one, subscribers line circuit called SLC. Every subscriber is connected to his local exchange by one pair of wires. At the exchange, every subscriber line terminates into its own subscriber line circuit called SLC. One SLC per subscriber. There are as many SLCs in the exchange as the number of subscribers. When the subscriber lifts his handset, current starts to flow on the line. This is detected by the SLC. What's the role of line finder and allotter? In an exchange, there are many subscribers but only a few selectors. Therefore, an allotter stage is required in between as an interface for finding a free selector and to connect the calling subscriber to that free selector. Once the allotter finds a free first selector, it is marked busy so that no other subscriber can be allotted this. Now the first selector sends a dial tone to the subscriber and then gets ready to receive the dialed pulses from the calling subscriber. The first selector passes on the dial pulses to the group selector when the switching system is heavily loaded. The capacity of the switching system reduces drastically by 20 to 40% due to special service numbers such as fire service, police ambulance and so on. What are the advantages? The step-by-step system is inexpensive. It's highly reliable due to distributed nature of the equipment. What could be the disadvantages? No alternative routing is possible since the call process is step-by-step. The Strowger system can handle only slow speed dialing, cannot handle DTMF of dialing, which is quite fast, suitable for only pulse dialing. The lifetime of moving parts is finite as we know, and therefore it is limited. Lots of mechanical components and this requires non-stop maintenance. Congestion could arise when the switching system is heavily loaded. The capacity of the switching system reduces drastically by 20 to 40% due to special service numbers such as fire service, police ambulance and so on. Let us look next at crossbar exchange. Between 1930 and 1940, AT&T introduced a new switch called crossbar. What's the basic principle? The fundamental concept of a crossbar switching is that it uses common control networks. These common control circuits handle or route several calls simultaneously through the switching network at the same time on a shared basis. The common control networks at the crossbar exchange perform all functions related to setting up, monitoring and disconnecting the call besides billing. The common control also facilitates uniform numbering of subscribers in a large area like a big city with multiple exchanges. The common control method of switching eliminates the disadvantages of step-by-step switching by receiving the entire number, all the digits, before processing the call. The important element of crossbar switch is a crossbar switching matrix. The basic crossbar matrix requires at least M by N sets of contacts and M plus N or less activators to select one of the contacts. What do we mean by this? Look at a 3 by 3 crossbar switch. It has an array of 3 horizontal and 3 vertical wires shown as H and V. Both H and V wires are connected to individual contact points and are normally kept separated, in other words, open. Two types of bars, known as horizontal and vertical bars shown as dotted lines, are mechanically connected to these contact points and are also attached to electromagnets as shown in the figure. Let's look at how switching is done. The horizontal and vertical wires both can be subscribers in a very small exchange, or the horizontal wires can be subscribers and the vertical wires can be trunks in a local exchange, or the horizontal and vertical wires both can be trunks in higher level group exchanges. All these three combinations are possible. Let's say that the switch is a very small exchange and there are 3 subscribers A, B and C connected to the horizontal wires, and D, E and F are connected to the vertical wires. If A wants to talk to E, magnets 4 and 2 are energized in that sequence, not 2 and 4. Please note, always horizontal magnet will be energized first. If B wants to talk to D, magnets 5 and 1 are energized. If C wants to talk to F, magnets 6 and 3 are energized. Please note that one common control circuit can service all these 3 calls simultaneously. That's a keyword here. One common control circuit and 3 calls will be progressed simultaneously. Please note that a maximum of only 3 calls are possible in this switch with 9 cross points. 9 is 3 square. When both horizontal and vertical bars connected to the electromagnet are activated, the contact of the intersection of the 2 bars will close together. Thus, the contact is made and continues to hold. It requires N square switching elements for N subscribers. We have just now seen this. Thus, for 50 subscribers, 2500 cross point switches are required. Therefore, crossbar is economical only for small private exchanges requiring a small amount of traffic. Features: one common control unit allows subscribers on the crossbar switch to share common equipments to process the call. Crossbar switches are easier to maintain because the switch have significantly fewer moving parts than the Strowger switching system. Let us look at manual exchanges in this slide. The operation is very simple and most of us already know this. The operation of the operator assisted manual exchange is very well known. These type of exchanges used switch assemblies and plugs and jacks. All the local exchange hardware are duplicated for each subscriber except the ringing generator, operator's headset and the battery. Let us say X wants to call Y. X lifts the handset and the exchange detects this loop. DC current flows in this loop. A lamp gets activated and the operator's attention is drawn to this. Operator then talks to X and finds out the number of the desired called party Y. Operator closes Y's circuit and rings him or her by using a ring key and a ring generator. User X is parked all the while. When Y answers, his LED is activated and the operator talks to Y and then patches X and Y through a patch card. Both lights of A and B are on as long as they talk. If any one or both lamps goes off, the operator will disconnect the jacks. Limitations of manual exchanges: it is language dependent, it lacks privacy, there could be a switching delay, the operator may be busy attending to several calls and one has to wait for one's turn. Only a limited number of features were possible. These are some of the drawbacks of manual exchanges. Then came step-by-step switching, the famous Strowger exchange. Look at the figure. The Strowger switching is a step-by-step switching. The system consists of elements such as subscribers line circuit, allotter, line finder, group selector and final selector. Figure shows the block diagram of a typical Strowger switching, which explains the process by which the switching system connects a calling subscriber and a called subscriber. Look at the new figure that's appearing. The figure shows a simplified routing of a local call in a Strowger switching system. The line finder shown is what is known as a two-motion selector. What's a two-motion selector? In the figure, look at the two-motion selectors in the group selector stage. Let us say the calling subscriber wants to talk to someone whose telephone number is 5345. Therefore, she dials 5345. In this example, the first digit received is 5 and the first two-motion selector wiper sweeps vertically to the fifth contact and it arrives at the fifth row of the two-motion selector. All the terminals on this row can connect eventually through other switches only to those phones whose first digit starts with 5. Now, this first selector connects to the second selector, which responds to the second digit. In our example, the second digit is 3. And therefore, the second two-motion selector wiper moves vertically to the third contact. This indicates that one of the many possible subscribers whose first two digits are 5 and 3 are selected. Still not the desired call party, but someone with starting number as 53. This process repeats in the next selector, which is a single switch called final selector. When this selector receives the first digit, the wiper moves vertically that many steps. When the selector receives the second digit, the wiper moves horizontally that many steps. The next two digits received are 4, 5 in our example, and you can see how the wiper has moved from this figure. That is where our desired call subscribers line is already terminated. Next one, subscribers line circuit called SLC. Every subscriber is connected to his local exchange by one pair of wires At the exchange, every subscriber line terminates into its own subscriber line circuit called SLC, one SLC per subscriber. There are as many SLCs in the exchange as the number of subscribers. When the subscriber lifts his handset, current starts to flow on the line. This is detected by the SLC. What's the role of line finder and allotter? In an exchange, there are many subscribers but only a few selectors. Therefore, an allotter stage is required in between as an interface for finding a free selector and to connect the calling subscriber to that free selector. Once the allotter finds a free first selector, it is marked busy so that no other subscriber can be allotted this. Now the first selector sends a dial tone to the subscriber and then gets ready to receive the dialed pulses from the calling subscriber. The first selector passes on the dialed pulses to the group selector when the switching system is heavily loaded. The capacity of the switching system reduces drastically by 20 to 40% due to special service numbers such as fire service, police ambulance and so on. What are the advantages? The step-by-step system is inexpensive, it's highly reliable due to distributed nature of the equipment. What could be the disadvantages? No alternative routing is possible since the call process is step-by-step. The Strowger system can handle only slow speed dialing, cannot handle DTM of dialing which is quite fast, suitable for only pulse dialing. The lifetime of moving parts is finite as we know and therefore it is limited. Lots of mechanical components and this requires non-stop maintenance. Congestion could arise when the switching system is heavily loaded. The capacity of the switching system reduces drastically by 20 to 40% due to special service numbers such as fire service, police ambulance and so on. Let us look next at crossbar exchange. Between 1930 and 1940, AT&T introduced a new switch called crossbar. What's the basic principle? The fundamental concept of a crossbar switching is that it uses common control networks. These common control circuits handle or route several calls simultaneously through the switching network at the same time on a shared basis. The common control networks at the crossbar exchange perform all functions related to setting up, monitoring and disconnecting the call besides billing. The common control also facilitates uniform numbering of subscribers in a large area like a big city with multiple exchanges. The common control method of switching eliminates the disadvantages of step-by-step switching by receiving the entire number, all the digits, before processing the call. The important element of crossbar switch is a crossbar switching matrix. The basic crossbar matrix requires at least M by N sets of contacts and M plus N or less activators to select one of the contacts. What do we mean by this? Look at a 3 by 3 crossbar switch. It has an array of 3 horizontal and 3 vertical wires shown as H and V. Both H and V wires are connected to individual contact points and are normally kept separated, in other words open. Two types of bars, known as horizontal and vertical bars shown as dotted lines, are mechanically connected to these contact points and are also attached to electromagnets as shown in the figure. Let's look at how switching is done. The horizontal and vertical wires both can be subscribers in a very small exchange, or the horizontal wires can be subscribers and the vertical wires can be trunks in a local exchange, or the horizontal and vertical wires both can be trunks in higher level group exchanges. All these three combinations are possible. Let's say that the switch is a very small exchange and there are 3 subscribers A, B and C connected to the horizontal wires and D, E and F are connected to the vertical wires. If A wants to talk to E, magnets 4 and 2 are energized in that sequence, not 2 and 4. Please note, always horizontal magnet will be energized first. If B wants to talk to D, magnets 5 and 1 are energized. If C wants to talk to F, magnets 6 and 3 are energized. Please note that one common control circuit can service all these 3 calls simultaneously. That's a keyword here. One common control circuit and 3 calls will be progressed simultaneously. Please note that a maximum of only 3 calls are possible in this switch with 9 cross points. 9 is 3 square. When both horizontal and vertical bars connected to the electromagnet are activated, the contact of the intersection of the two bars will close together. Thus, the contact is made and continues to hold. It requires n square switching elements for n subscribers. We have just now seen this. Thus, for 50 subscribers, 2500 cross point switches are required. Therefore, crossbar is economical only for small private exchanges requiring a small amount of traffic. Features: one common control unit allows subscribers on the crossbar switch to share common equipments to process the call. Crossbar switches are easier to maintain because the switch have significantly fewer moving parts than the Strowger switching system. Let us look at stored program exchanges in this slide. Stored program exchange is abbreviated as SPC. What is SPC exchange? We had seen the Strowger's step-by-step switching system and also the crossbar switching system. In both these types, electromechanical components were used for both switching and control elements. In 1965, Bell System came up with the first computer control switching system called Stored Program Control System. SPC uses a digital computer with a stored program for its control functions. The SPC supports a lot of additional features such as abbreviated dialing, call forwarding, call waiting, billing, and so on. Let's look at the basics of SPC. Look at the figure that's on your screen now. In SPC, a specific set of instructions called program are stored in its memory and executed automatically one by one by a high-speed versatile processor. The exchange functions such as control and switching, besides the additional feature, are carried out through the specific programs stored in the memory of a computer. This led to the name Stored Program Control. A computer can be programmed to test the status of input lines and output lines and act appropriately. All switching systems manufactured for use as public switching systems now use computers and software programming to control the switching of calls. Using SPC, the loop current and voltage requirements are improved. 20 milliamps transmitter loop current and 52 volts battery feed, for example. And this results in longer subscriber loop lengths. Basic view of SPC telephony switch is shown in this figure with a basic control structure of a SPC telephony exchange. What is the basic control structure of SPC? The SPC uses processors designed to meet the various requirements of the exchange. Processors are duplicated in hot standby mode to prevent breakdowns and consequently improve the reliability. The SPC system uses distributed software and hardware architectures. A separate processor looks after the maintenance functions of the switching system. Mainly, the SPC performs trunk routing to other exchanges, supports switching, control functions, monitoring of subscribers, billing, new special features, and so on. There are two types in SPC exchanges, namely centralized SPC and distributed SPC. What is centralized SPC? Look at this figure. Early electronic switching systems were centralized SPC exchanges and used a single processor to perform the exchange functions. Currently, centralized exchanges use dual processors for high reliability. What is distributed SPC? Look at this new figure. Then came the distributed SPC. Customers could get a wider range of services using distributed SPC than through centralized or electromechanical switching systems. Centralized switching uses one or two processors, whereas in distributed switching, the workload is partitioned into specific segments and are delegated to separate small processors referred as regional processors. A central processor, of course, is still required to direct the regional processors and to perform more complex tasks. The distributed SPC offers better availability and reliability than the centralized SPC. This figure shows the distributed control where switching equipment is divided into parts, each of which has its own processor.